Good Wednesday evening, Temple Baptist. Hope you're doing well. Looking forward to a great time of worship this coming Sunday as we turn our attention towards Easter, the crucifixion of our Lord, the resurrection of our Lord. This week we're going to be dealing with the triumphal entry of our Lord going into Jerusalem for that very last time. So I hope you're going to plan to be with us on Sunday, whether online or in person. We're just excited about that opportunity to worship. Our Wednesday night study, we're still in the book of James. We're in chapter 5. We're going to take the next 3 weeks and sort of work through a very important passage, basically verses 7 through 20. We're going to take about 3 weeks to get through this because we've seen James at this point as a very practical letter. He has been providing a picture of just shirt sleeve Christianity. And as we looked in chapter 5, as that sort of opened, he'd been focusing on the sins and the condemnation of the rich. And now he's going to turn to those who the rich have been oppressing. What is to be their reaction of those that have been abused and oppressed by those that were wealthy? And as he begins to describe that reaction, how they're to handle that oppression of the rich, the answer is really just one word. And it's one word that we sort of struggle with. It's the word patience. So I don't know about you, but patience is one of those things that are very difficult for me at times. And what James is going to tell us, what we're going to focus on tonight is just down to verses 11. We're going to see that Christians are called to be people of patience. We're going to break it down in basically two sections. First of all, we're going to see the necessity of patience. Look at verse 7. He says, "Be patient, therefore, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. Behold, the farmer waits for the precious produce of the soil, being patient about it until it gets early and late rains." So we see that this passage begins then with a command. It's a command to be patient. And the Greek word here that's translated patience is sort of a rare ancient Greek word. There's a reason for that. Patience was not considered to be a virtue by the Greeks. They admired the man who was able to retaliate quickly against any injustice and who sort of brought vengeance upon his enemy. So it wasn't something that was lifted very high by the Greeks. You only have to look at their folk tales and their legends to see example of that attitude that they have. But when James tells believers to be patient, you would expect him to use the present tense. That is to be continually patient. But he doesn't use that tense. He doesn't do that. Instead, he uses the aorist tense. He calls men to be patient in a point in time. In other words, it's be patient now. And why does he say it that way? Well, I'll be honest, I'm not really sure. Maybe it's because these believers were going through some special hardships at a particular time that require immediate patience. Or perhaps it was because I can only be patient for today. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. But it's very peculiar, the word he uses there, to command them to be patient, and to be patient now. And on the other hand, there's a time limit attached to this command to be patient. Verse 7, you know, that time limit is given. You're to be patient, it says, until when? Until the coming of the Lord. So we're not called to be patient forever. You know, not even the Lord is going to be patient forever. There's going to come a time when even the Lord's patience will end, and it will be at his coming. And so this sort of tells me something about the patience, about the Christian view of patience. Christian patience has a goal in sight. And this is seen in the illustration that James gives us in the second part of the verse. He says, "Behold, the farmer waits for the precious soil, produce of the soil, being patient about it until it gets the early and late rains." So the farmer here is pictured. He's not the common laborer. He's not the day laborer. He's the landowner. He's the one who has invested in the fruit of his labors. He gets up each morning, he goes out, he plows the ground, he plants the seed, he pulls out the weeds, he cultivates, and he fertilizes, and then he waits. And then as a farmer, he waits even more for a long time, and nothing happens. The fruit will not come until a long time has passed. First, the early rains will come. That sort of ushers in a series of thunderstorms in October or November, and they result in sort of the softening of the hard baked soil, and they begin to make it fertile. And then the latter rains come in April and May, and that's accompanied by the warmer temperatures, and these rains help to ripen and mature the fruit, increasing the yield that's given off. And this was a familiar picture to the Jewish people. I mean, the Old Testament used the early and latter rains as a picture of the blessings of God upon their nation. Now, you can go to Jeremiah chapter 3, you can go to Hosea chapter 6, you can go to Joel, you can go to Zechariah. They all talk about the blessings of God upon the nation, and they use these latter rains as the picture of that. And I think there's a lesson there for us that we just need to notice, and because perhaps we're going through one of those dry seasons in our lives, one of those times when you just don't seem to be having things going your way. I think there's a message there for us as believers that the rains are on the way. To just sort of be patient. The rains are on the way. They will come. God will provide. So just a great message there. Wherever you are in life, however difficult it may be that everything just seems to be going against you. Man, it just seems the soil is just becoming hard and baked. The great promises that those latter rains that the Lord provides, the blessedness of being His children, those things are on the way. So as we begin to open up, as James describes this response of his people, of the Lord's people, he first called for us to be patient. So we see that necessity of patience. Then in the second part, in verses 8 through 9, we see a reward of patience. He says, you too be patient, strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Now let me read that again. You be patient, strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not complain, brethren, against one another, that you yourselves may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. You know, there's a string of commands given by James, and each one of them continues in this same aorist tense, which means not only do it, but do it now. There's an urgency in the Greek language. There's an urgency in his tone. He's saying, be patient now, strengthen your hearts, and do it right now. So how do you master then this quality of patience? How do we have this patience? How do we master that? We all struggle. Well, we master it by going to the source of the patience. You know, the source is given to us in this passage. The source of patience is in our eventual reward. He says the coming of the Lord is what? The coming of the Lord is at hand, is imminent. It could take place at any moment. And so as Christians, we need to live in light of the return of Christ. And in doing so, there's two possible extremes that we can go to. And we see these all the time. And we see them even in the biblical text. You know, the first extreme is the one who views the return of Christ as being so close that they make no plans for the future. We see that sort of thinking in the early church that eventually led some to just quit their jobs and to just not provide anything because the coming of the Lord is just going to be so close. We see that in an issue in the early church. The Thessalonians sort of deals with that. A lot of people say, well, the Lord's coming. I'm just not going to work. I don't need money. I don't need to do any of those things. I'm just going to wait till the Lord comes. So that's one extreme, is just to say he's coming at any moment and I don't need to plan anything. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to work. I don't need to do. I can just run up my credit card debt because it really doesn't matter. So that's one extreme. And then the other extreme is that thinking that the Lord's coming is so far off that it has no impact on our lives. And, you know, after a while, we can forget that he's even coming at all. So he tells us, you know, we can't really live within those two extremes. We can't just not plan. He's already talked about planning in the previous chapter and how we do it, but how we plan in pencil and how we give the Lord consideration in all of our planning. But now he's saying this sort of the same thing in our patience. The reward of our patience, the source of our patience, what allows us to have the patience that James is encouraging us to have is to know that the Lord comes and that the Lord is coming. So regardless of what we're dealing with, regardless of how difficult life may become for us, we have the wonderful promise that one day our Lord will return. So that's the source of our patience. That's what drives us to be able to live this type of life. So we see the reward of our patience is Jesus is coming. So there's two things we've seen so far. James makes it clear the necessity for patience. And he makes it clear the reward of patience. And then he gives an example of patience. Look at verse 10. As an example, brethren, of suffering and patience, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we count those blessed who endured. You have heard of the endurance of Job, and you have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealings, that the Lord is full of compassion and he's merciful. So the stories of the Old Testament fathers are stories of patience. Now you say, well, why do you say that? Well, why do we say that? Because if they all look forward to the coming of the Lord, but none of them saw it in their day. Take, for example, Hebrews 11, verse 13. It says, all these died in faith without receiving the promises, but having seen them and having welcomed them from a distance and having confessed that they are strangers and exiles on the earth. Just think about Abraham. Abraham was given a promise of a seed that would fill the entire earth. Did he live to see that promise fulfilled in his lifetime? No, he died without seeing that entire fulfillment. Yet the story of Abraham is not a story of failure. We don't look at Abraham and say, man, that poor fool waiting all those years for nothing. Instead, we consider Abraham to have been greatly blessed. And James tells us in verse 11, we count those blessed who endured. That phrase is translated, we count those blessed, is a transliteration of a Greek word. And it's the same root word that Jesus uses in the Beatitudes. You remember when Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the gentle. So it's a root word of that same word that James is using here. So we can translate that by saying happy. You know, James is saying we see these Old Testament saints as being happy because they endured, or blessed because they endured. And this is significant because endurance is not normally considered to be a very happy quality, if you think about it. You know, endurance, when we think about endurance, it tends to be surrounded more with just a bit of just being monotonous. It describes that daily grind. We're enduring. We're hanging on. We don't think of happy. We don't think of joyful. It's sort of like the way Chuck Swindoll puts it. He says, the problem with daily life is that it's daily. And so enduring sometimes has that connotation of just being unhappy and being a daily grind. But James makes it seem to think that happy are those who endure. How can enduring people be counted as happy? It's because there's a worthy goal that's to be obtained as a result of their endurance. You know, there's coming a day when we shall be done with enduring, and we then hear those words, well done, thy good and faithful servant. And in those times when you wonder whether you're being good enough or faithful enough, you have to remember the message of the gospel is that the Lord is full of compassion and he's full of mercy. So this is just a fascinating portion of scripture as we begin to delve down into it. We're not going to have time tonight to move on to the rest of this passage all the way down to verse 20, but we're going to stop here. But let's just think about what we've heard. He's really dealing with these believers that are being oppressed by those that are wealthy, that are rich. And you know, oftentimes we feel like the world is oppressing us. Because of our faith, because of the way we try to live, we may feel it at work, we may feel it at school, we may feel it out in culture. But the word to us, our response to that oppression, is that we are to be people of patience. We're to be people of patience, and he calls us to that. We see that necessity of patience. We see that great reward of patience. That great reward of patience is that one day, our reward will be that our Lord Jesus will come and he'll receive us, and we no longer have to endure the oppression. We no longer have to endure the hardship. So we see that great reward of our patience as we live that out. And then James gives us a great example. All of those that have gone before us, man, they didn't get to see all of the promises fulfilled. The prophets didn't, that prophesied the coming of the Messiah, they didn't get to see that, but they're counted blessed because they were said to be happy or blessed because they endured. And we can associate our endurance with a sense of peace, a sense of happiness, and a sense of blessedness. Folks, I hope this has been a great word for you, because we do live in a very peculiar time where there seems to be an attack every direction on our faith, on us living out our faith. And God doesn't call us to retaliate. God calls us to be people of patience. And next week, we're going to dive in a little deeper, and he's going to take us, not only are we to be called a people of patience, but we're to be a people of promise. So that's what we're going to look at next week as we begin in verse 12 moving forward. Church, let me take just a moment and pray for you. Remember to pray for each other. Remember to encourage each other. Remember to gather with us on Sunday as we make preparations to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. A lot of opportunities coming up. We've got the worship this Sunday that we will celebrate Jesus entering into Jerusalem. Then Thursday, we have a Maundy Thursday service. It's going to be a great time of worship. It's going to be capped off with us gathering together and receiving the Lord's Supper together as the body of Christ. Man, it's been a long time since we've been able to do that. So make plans to be there and be a part of that. Your leaders, your staff are putting together a great night of worship. So make plans to come and participate in that. And then, like I said, if you're not at a place where you're able to come, but please jump online, be a part of the body that way. That's a vital importance for us. And hey, let's use this online opportunity as an opportunity to share our worship services, share our Bible studies, just get the word of God out there that people might encounter it. It's a great way to just see it as a mission field, as an opportunity to send God's word out. So when we have those live worship events, make sure you like it, make sure you share it, so those that follow you on Facebook can plug in, jump in. Who knows how God can use that? Just a moment of celebration, especially as we get up on this time of Easter, it'd be a great opportunity to allow the word of God to impact others. Church, let me pray for you. And as we prepare to end our time tonight, and look forward to worship on Sunday. Father, we recognize that as your people, Lord, our living out that faith, Lord, is expensive to us sometimes. Lord, it feels like that we, Lord, have those moments of oppression where our jobs or our school or just culture in general, Lord, really isn't comfortable with us living out our faith. And Lord, you don't call us to retaliate. Lord, you don't call us to act as the world would act in response, but Lord, you call us to be people of patience. Lord, help us to see that command. Help us to see that imperative. Lord, help us to realize the reward of our patience, Father, is your coming, and Lord, our being with you for all of eternity. So Lord, just encourage us today as we seek to be men and women of patience, Lord, that represent you well as we seek to live out our faith. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless, church. Looking forward to seeing you on Sunday. Take care.